Education Department workshop. I'm the honor of introducing to you Dr. Oanh Nguyễn Lâm. She's a longtime advocate of equal and quality education for all. She was elected to the Garden Grove School Board in 2004. She's also the Associate Director for Center for Language Minority Education Research at Cal State Berkeley and a Vietnamese language professor at UCLA.
Curriculum comes to be at your school.
in your classroom, somebody has to make that decision. All of that is part of the political process. A lot of time, we tend to study what's given to us without thinking critically. So that's what I want to be able to show you today. Have you heard of that name, Paulo Freire? Raise your hand if you have. He's a very influential person in modern history of education over the world, except in the United States. Okay, in some circle in the United States, people know of him. He coined the difference between reading the word, what's written, and reading the world, understanding the context of what you are being taught. And his story came from his work in Brazil when he was assigned by the Brazilian government to take a group of literacy workers to teach the Brazilian farmers how to read and write. And so at first he attempted to do that and they were not successful. He and his workers were not successful because after a long day of working on the field, people didn't care about reading and writing. They didn't see how that could help them become better farmers. So they came to those evening classes falling asleep, not motivated, not wanting to learn. So after a few months, he said, stop. He told us this, you know, the literacy workers, let's not do this anymore. We need to find out what did we do wrong. And the only way to do that is to learn from these people. So he told his literacy workers to follow these people and observe them. And he did the same and he took notes. So a few weeks later, he brought his workers back. He showed them two pictures. He showed them one picture, a picture of a Brazilian farmer with a bottle. He is drinking and he's walking on the street. So he asked his worker, what do you see? And the literacy workers, most of them are college students from the city, big city. They said, oh, he's a drunken man, he's unemployed, he doesn't have a job, he's depressed, he's drinking. He said, okay. Then he brought them to a meeting with the farmers, and he showed the same picture to the farmers, and he said, what do you see? And the farmer said, wow, that wretch has got paid. He already paid all his bills, gave money to his wife, to his kid, he took care of his needs, so he has extra money, he went out and partying, you know, he's drinking, he's celebrating. Two different answers. So his you turn around to the workers and he said, see, you know, you cannot work with people when you don't know what they're thinking, what their context. And so he assigned them to go and learn from the farmers, write out everything. And then in the evening, he would use what the literacy workers had listened, observed from the workers and use that as a test. So if they were talking about, you know, what to do with the soil, what to put in, those became the vocabulary. And so the workers became very motivated. And he asked them to give him words. And he asked them to tell him stories about farming and the things that happened in their lives. Then he asked them, why is your soil not good? Why is this so expensive? Why this equipment is not available in your area? So he asked them questions and they start talking. As they talk, he wrote down the text. So using that method, he was able to raise the level of literacy of the people to the level where people are not just learning to read and write, but also to question the system. He was so successful that these literacy workers write letters of complaints to the government saying, you know, you cheated us, you promised us this and this, and it didn't happen, the equipment was lousy, this and that. So they banned him from teaching. They said, you're supposed to teach people to read and write, not to question, not to challenge, not to find more information. But it had caught on. People see learning as something that gives them power. And so that method spread in many of the South American countries. And then he was exiled. He had to go into exile because the government felt that being educated was a threat to the power structure. So he came to the United States and he started using that technique with a group of workers in the Appalachian Mountains. Again, people started to question the government using the skills that they had. And so So that's when people begin to see the strong connection between education and politics. But it didn't just happen with one person, it happened before that. Who is that person? You remember that in history books? Rosa Parks. What do you remember about reading, studying about Rosa Parks? And I remember, I was an elementary school teacher for a number of years, and I remember teaching the story every, what month? Black History Month? February. And it's the same story. And it was not a true story. I was teaching the kid a version of a history that was not true until 2 years later when I found out, whoa, you know, there's something missing here. So what version were you taught when you were in grade school?
She was tired.
She refused to get up. And so she started the boycott of the bus. All that, right? She was tired, but she was not tired from a long day of working as a seamstress, as you know, the textbooks had written. She was tired of what? That was the, you know, in the textbook it said she was trying to work out as a seamstress. But she was actually an active member of the NAACP. So she was tired of being mistreated. So when she refused to get up, it wasn't because she was physically tired. It was a conscious decision to take action. I'm tired of being treated like this. I will tolerate no more. But why did the textbook say she was physically tired? Why did they teach us that instead of the other version?
It's easier to conceptualize for younger kids, I think. But I mean, if you go into more depth about what really happened, and you really understand her state of mind, mm-hmm. that, I mean, that the oppression for so long, and it's,
right.
it builds, and eventually it has to be some sort of corruption. So.
Exactly. Because if you, exactly, if you teach a real version, kids who feel that they've been oppressed will rise up, and the teachers will have no control, right? And thus the establishment do not want that to happen. And so all the curriculum that has been taught in school has been sanitized so that as students, we go through school accepting things without questioning, thinking without critically analyzing, okay? That's what political about education. And when you get that kind of education, you're just preserving the status quo. You're just fitting into where people want you to fit, okay? And there are different structures for different groups of people. If you look at the history of education in the United States, some of us heard about the boarding school for Native Americans. Okay, there was a policy that was written, okay, that says that the whole process of education is to deculturalize and Americanize. What does the term deculturalize mean? When you de something, what does it mean? You strip people, students, kids, young children, of whatever culture that they bring with them to school. You strip it away and you make them into mainstream white Caucasian Anglo-Americans. And it worked for many years. Why did it? For a certain group of people, it worked very well. For the European immigrants, it worked very well. Why? That process of education, deculturalizing and Americanizing, worked for white European immigrants who came from European countries. But didn't work for African Americans, didn't work for Asian Americans, for Puerto Rican Americans. Why did it work for one group and not the other?
That's right.
Yeah, because if you look similar, if you have the similar racial background, you can be stripped of that culture, you can blend in, you can melt into that melting pot. But if you're physically different, it didn't work. And one didn't work, you've been stripped of your primary culture and identity, but you're not being accepted by the second culture, then where are you?
You're in the margin. That's a term called marginalization. You're in the margin. You don't fit in anywhere. And that's where we see a whole generation of kids going in the wrong direction because they don't have an identity. Okay. Looking at American history in terms of education, everybody heard of the case that's really changed the landscape of public education in the United States. Brown versus Board of Education. In 2004, we celebrated the 50th anniversary. If you were a college student on any campus, you probably have heard some activities about that. Okay. But it didn't just people didn't just try to achieve educational equity at that time. It happened years before that, but it was not successful. This is a lesser known case. I don't know if anyone has heard that. Plessy versus Ferguson. It happened in 1892. Plessy was a man who was 1/8 black, 7/8 white. And at that time they had trains with different cars, you know, cars for white, car for black. And because he's 7/8 white, he felt that he could sit in the white because he looked white. But for some reason, you know, he was punished. He was told to move and he fought it and he lost because they said that if the train had gone into different states, then it would have violated the federal law of equal protection. But if it's just in one state, I think it was Alabama, then the state can set the law for that state. There's a national, you know, 14th Amendment that applied at the federal level, but it is a state. So because of that case from 1892 to 1954, there was a lot of cases that went to Supreme Court, but the Supreme Court decided not to do anything because they abided with the Plessy-Ferguson case. Okay. What happened in Brown versus Board of Education in 1954? If that case didn't happen, what would happen to us? Would you be able to get the same education that you do now? No. There will be separate schools for different groups of people. It depends on what you look like. It depends on how dark your skin colors are. So that case has historic significance, and we all benefited from that. But there's a case that is much more special, that little nun. Has anyone heard of that? Mendes versus Westminster. And it happened 6-7 years before Brown. And it happened where? In Westminster. Where's Westminster? Orange County, Southern California. A few hours from here. Okay, that's a picture of Gonzalo and Felicitas Mendez. Okay, they're Puerto Rican Americans. It happened in 1946. What happened in the war in 1946?
World War II.
Gonzalo was a worker for a Japanese farm. Okay, in World War II, what happened to the Japanese Americans? They were interns. So before the Japanese that were his boss went into the camp, he allowed Gonzalo to lease his farm, to work off of that farm and take the profit so that when he came out of camp, the farm would not be stolen, would be returned to him. So Gonzalo was able to lease the farm from Japanese Americans who went into internment camp. He was able to make some money, and he was able to use that money to fight in court for his children. His children were not allowed to go to a neighborhood school. They were told to go to a Mexican school, which was so far away, and it was just like a shed versus a real school building. I'll show you a picture of the Mexican school. And he's not even Mexican. He's Puerto Rican American. He had been in the country for many generations. And his sister's kids, they're also Puerto Rican American, but they look white. The skin's lighter. American, the Latino Americans, the Jewish Americans, the African American. All the groups got together to fight it. Okay? And because they won in California, it set precedent for Brown. Here's the pictures of what the Mexican school looked like. Okay? If it weren't for these cases, this is where we might have been sent to school. What's significant about this is a lot of time, if we don't take time to learn the real inclusive American history, we take things for granted. We think that, you know, this country is great, wonderful, just because it is. No, a lot of people, okay, have to struggle for the benefits that we have today. So this case has so much significance. And yet, kids, Latino kids, Asian American kids, Caucasian kids in Westminster do not know the story. We have a curriculum, but the district would not allow to be taught. We have a professional development for teachers, so that teachers know how to share this information with kids. But the district say, no, we just want to teach them to be combined and do math. That's, you know, not the curriculum. Let's not teach them that. They don't need to know that. There's two other court cases that's very significant. One is called Lau versus Nichols. It happened in San Francisco Union High School District, and a group of Chinese Americans who were new to the country, they did speak English very well, and they couldn't understand the instruction that was all in English. They were failing. And so they sued. They said, you know, we didn't get this, the same opportunity to learn as other kids who are fluent in English. And the district say, no, you're wrong. We taught you the same thing we taught everybody. We gave you equal treatment. Everybody's the same. You know, you're the same class, you have the same teachers. We didn't put you in a separate class. You have the same class, same books, same teachers. So, you know, we didn't do anything illegally. So you can't sue us. But the attorney that helped them said, no, how can it be equal when these kids don't get what the teacher's talking about? They don't have the language to understand, so it's not equal. So it was fought. Okay. What was interesting about the Lau versus Nichols is that there's law dated back in 1964 that says all taxpayers of all races, you know, should not be discriminated. Everybody pay taxes. And so no group should be discriminated. Okay. There's also guidelines in 1968 and 70 that says if students are deficient, that means they don't have the language skill, then the school needs to do something about it. There's all these laws that have already been in place, and yet the school district refused to do anything to help the Chinese American students until a lawsuit was brought to the school district. And then after that court case, another decision that went all the way to the Supreme Court, the Lau versus Nichols, all the school districts in California and all the states had to hire bilingual teachers, bilingual instructional aides to help the students when they first came to the country. This is significant because people like me, who came to this country at the age of 15, like your parents, who went to school when they were older, who didn't understand English, got help. Without this, you know, court case, the school district would just ignore it, and that is set in the back. Okay. And so these court cases set precedent to the level of education that we were able to get. Very recently, there's a court case that is known as Williams case. It was brought by a group of Samoan Pacific Islander American in LA Unified School District. And the parents said, how can my kids learn when the school facility is so bad, the toilet is so dirty, the kids are afraid to go there. And if they can't, you know, release themselves, they won't be able to learn. They don't have good textbooks. The books are outdated. And the teachers are not qualified. And so they brought a lawsuit. It took years and years and years. But when Governor Schwarzenegger came in, finally signed and said, okay, we settled this. And so it became known as the three T's, toilet, teachers, technology. provide credential. If they don't have those, the parents can file a complaint against the district. Okay. And these court cases were brought by Asian American and Pacific Islanders. People tend to think of API as quiet, submissive, don't rock the boat. But there are instances in which we make history. You need to know that, identify with that. We came to this country in 1975. That was the first wave of Vietnamese American refugees. Before 1975, were there Vietnamese in the United States?
Yes.
They study abroad, students. They came to study, but then they go back. Very few, hardly anybody stayed. They just came to study and then went back to Vietnam. My father came to work in Washington, D.C. in 1956. One of my sisters was born here, and then he went back to Vietnam. A lot of people like that wouldn't stay because this is not our home. What happened in 1975? Okay. We had a civil war, North and South. Communists won the war, and so the people in the South from the exodus. So in 1975, why did the United States take us in?
Because they were just at the war.
Yeah, they were part of the war. Okay, they were capitalists. So morally, they were obligated to help us out, to take us in. However, they had a policy, and all this became known recently. The policy at that time was, don't let any group of Vietnamese congregate in one place. We don't want ethnic and faith. Okay? Okay. The policy was to disperse and scatter them all across the United States. They set up 5 major refugee camps in places that you would think to put people who came from a tropical country, like Pennsylvania, Colorado, Arkansas, Florida, California is okay, but it's in the desert. Camp Pendleton. Okay. So these camps were set up and different groups, you know, my family came to the camp in Arkansas, at Fort Chaffee. These were the military bases. We brought to these camps. And while you're in the camp, they taught you American culture. They taught you survival English so that you can, you know, start living life. But you can't just walk out of camp. You have to be sponsored out of camp. A family has to sponsor you because you are not able to, you are not seen fit to just walk into American life. You have to be sponsored. And that American is supposed to teach you the American way. Okay? So when you leave camp, you left with a family waiting for you. You don't live with a family, but you know they serve as your sponsor. And the policy is don't allow those people to go to college. We don't have time for that. We don't have money to pay for them. Only ESL classes. And those are called ESL classes. And the curriculum for those classes, how to take orders, how to receive instructions to work as a cheap labor manual type of work. And that's how most of the adults in that first wave had to go through. And we accepted it. We accepted it in those positions. At the same time, we know that we're going to push our kids to go through college. We can't go to college. My parents, that's what they had to do. My father, who was a diplomat in Vietnam, who was a governor in Vietnam, worked for many different governments. He worked as a janitor, custodian, dishwasher in those first years. Had the United States allowed those people to get retrained, they would have a much more educated workforce from the start. But that was to fill in the lowest rank in the society because that's where the cheap labor is needed. Okay? Same policy, you have to understand that every policy that took place is based on economic of this country. So this is what I want to ask you. How do you see yourself? Where are you? What is your story? What is our history? How do you expect to know your history? Your history is not just what you learned in school. Your history is also the history of your family, of our community. How are you going to get that? Where? Okay. that I share with you. That's American history. And not many of us get that part of history either. The history that we get in school is very exclusive. It's not inclusive. Okay? And I said earlier that we have been benefited from the struggles of many groups. What's our part? How can I contribute to that? We can't just take. Okay? I see a lot of discriminations in our own community against other groups. We adopted those kind of biases and discrimination from the other groups and acted the same way. I get very offended every time I hear the way the owners of restaurants and supermarkets talk to the Mexican workers. Amigo, amigo, you know, like they don't have names. And, you know, they forgot that we are here because of struggles of other groups that came for us. And as generations should get an education, you need to remind the community, you need to set examples for being more respectful and inclusive. I want to, at this point, show you what happened in Westminster just a couple months ago as a case study of how we can get involved in community action. Okay. How many of you have heard of this case? Oanh Nguyễn Lâm is my last name. And what happened in Westminster? What was it involved? Raise your hand if you have heard of it. Okay. Okay, only a few. Raise your hand if you have never heard of this case. Okay, very good. Okay. And that's me. In the orange shirt, standing in the back. Okay. That was taken from Asian Week magazine. Okay, what happened was in January of this year, there was a notice of a vacancy, an opening as a superintendent of the school district in my area. So when I saw that notice, I said, I know the schools, I work with the teachers, I trained the principals, I know the parents in the community, I'm interested. So I inquired, and when I looked at the list of the qualifications, I said, I have all these qualifications, I'm going to apply. So I did apply, okay? And I submitted my applications, and it was accepted. When you submitted your applications, they had to check to make sure you have all the qualifications that the description called for. So in April, I was told that, you know, I'm going to have an interview. And it's a big process because they hired a company, a national company, to conduct the search. So when they sent out the notice, they had all this long list of qualifications. And how did they get qualifications? It came from, you know, in order to be in this position, you have these basic credentials and degrees you have to have. And then they interview the board members, they interview the teachers, the principals, the parents, they interview the mayor of the city, the police chief, business leaders. Okay. What are you looking for in an ideal superintendent? They develop a profile. So based on this profile, they did the paper screening. And the application package is this thing. So you have to fill all this out, you have to submit all these documents. Then you said, then they screen, they select 15 applicants. They said these 15 meet our criteria. So we're going to interview them. Because they don't have time to interview all 15, they select the 7 top. So I made a 15, then I made, you know, one of the 7 top. Then I was one of the 7 that interviewed on May 16th. After the first interview, they liked what I had to say. So out of the 7, they selected the top 3. I made it one of the top 3. I went in for my second interview on May 23rd. After that interview, I was offered a position. So congratulations, you know, the board have voted to select you as the next superintendent, and you are to start on July 1st. Okay. And you realize what is that position until? He oversees a district of 10,000 students, 500 teachers, 2,500 other workers and personnel. He's in charge of a budget that is $80 million a year. You charge of transportation, nutrition, curriculum, instruction. You answer to the board. You implement the law of the state and of the federal in terms of education. Big job. And they said, remember, this is a 24/7 job. You cannot, you always have to leave your number with the police department, with you know, all these people. You can never be out of touch. That's what they told me when I accepted the job. Well, they sent out press releases. It was LA Times, Oshkosh Register, all the major Vietnamese newspapers. It was big news. Because up until then, there's no Vietnamese who even move up to the level of leadership in education as much as principal. There's no principals in this entire country that's Vietnamese American. So from principalship to superintendentship, it's a big jump. You oversee all the principals. So it was huge news for our community across the United States. I even got congratulatory notes from Vietnam, from Australia, because it was a crime, a collective crime. However, it lasted 1 week, exactly 1 week. After the press release, this was set out, people started to call the board members, how can you choose somebody who's not, I don't know, American? How can you choose somebody who's this or that, you know, pressuring the board? And a lot of these groups that called had power over the board members. There was a 5-member board, so 4 voted for me to select me. 1 said no, okay, because she said that I was not in the classroom for too long. I was in the classroom for 13 years, but she had other reasons. Anyway, after 1 week, they said, we're going to re-vote. We're going to have another meeting to vote again. So you please be prepared. So I said, how can you vote again? This has never been done before. So I called a couple of friends. I said, can they do this? People said, no, this has never been done before. Once they vote, because this is an important position, not something that you can change your mind. It's not like buying a car and 3 days later you can return. Well, in May 30th, they had a special meeting. Before they have the closed session to decide, they open it to the public. 200 people came, and that was, you know, the Tuesday before, after Memorial Day weekend. 200 people out of their own just came. They said, how could this be? And about half came from the Latino community, half came from the Vietnamese community. About 40-some people spoke on my behalf. I didn't attend the meeting. I just stayed home. I said, let them make the decision. After they listened to 45 people speaking, only 2 people say, we don't want her. 43 people said, keep your decision, we want this person. The board still changed their vote. The board still changed their vote. So a coalition was quickly formed. A coalition made up of Vietnamese educators, concerned members, and Latino community members. And they organized a rally. From May 30th to June 15th, only 15 days, they were able to organize a rally that brought together over 600 people, okay, to say that, listen, we don't like what you're doing, we want you to listen to us, okay? So I want to show you some of the things that happened at the rally. The rally, the theme for the rally was for all the children, it carried on the legacy of the Mendez case. Mendez case was out of todos los niños. So they were saying, we're doing this for the children. Here's somebody who's been education for 25 years. She knows our community. She speaks Spanish to our parents. She speaks Vietnamese to our parents. She speaks English, of course. She's from the community. Keep her for our kids. So that was the theme. Some of the pictures. And these are parents who have never been involved in any community. That Sylvia Mendez, she was a child when the Mendez case happened. She was the one whose father fought so that she could come to the school, to the white school. So she came back, she said, let's not make history happen in this way again. Let's make better history. So she came back and spoke at that rally. It was very historic because she hadn't been back to the school since then. And she said, racism still exists, we need to fight it. And so a lot of people came, and the American to target, to bring attention to the mainstream media. So we said, no Vietnamese flag, no flags of any kind, no Mexican flag, no signs in Vietnamese or Spanish. Everything is English. This is about education in public schools. Okay. Three things that people demand: fairness, respect, and quality education. And that was the thing that people were most concerned. The person in the middle is Daniel Dokan. He's a lawyer, and he's one of the organizers for the rally. The woman in the picture, she's an Anglo-Karen. She spoke on my behalf. She was a parent in the district where I worked as a school board member. She said that Kim Oanh was a peacemaker. She brought the Anglo, Latino, Vietnamese parents together as one group, so let's keep her. Another student in the district talked about, you know, wanting to have more teachers who can understand the family. And the one at the bottom is a UCLA student who came and spoke. So these people normally, they just, you know, stay out of conference, but for this reason, they came. Parents. We had different parents who had never had done any public speaking, also were moved to come out and speak and say, listen to us, this is what we want. The board would not give a specific answer why they changed the vote. They didn't say, oh, she was not qualified because this is this. They just say, you know, we changed our mind. There was no answer given. It was very unique because this event brought together people, young and old, students and professionals, parents, homemakers, business people, business leaders, religious leaders, all kinds of people who had never, you know, been in the same physical space before. We had groups from different community. Those two women, their justice and dignity, came from NULAC. What does NULAC stand for?
I think League of Nine Latin Americans.
So these people came on their own. Okay. We have multilingual media. We have CBS, KTLA, KCAL, 11, KLC, SBTM, Univision, Univision, every time. All kind of media came. We were also on NPR. You see, people coming together because they believe it was best for the kids. What really surprised people was that so many young people were there. Most of the time, the young people like you guys rarely come to these community events, and yet they show up. They show up. Okay. This got to the core of, they look at this case that here's a person who followed the rules, who played by the mainstream rules, got an education, got on in the streets, went through the process, been selected, and then suddenly got the rug pulled out on her. If this would happen to her, what about us? That motivated them to take action. Okay. There's a sense of collective empowerment when people come together for a shared purpose. After the rally, in which there were speakers that spoke, parents, students, I also spoke, people organized to walk into the boardroom. This is a meeting, the board meeting that went on. Have you ever been to any kind of board meeting? City or school? Yeah? Okay. So people, for many of these people, they have never been into a board meeting of any kind. So they line up to walk into it. They're holding signs, okay? And we want, the rally wanted people to understand who is behind this. What is a power structure? Who's making all this decision? The people out there. And these are, you know, mothers and fathers. There's a sense of hope because they feel like, oh, you know, when we come together, so many of us, we should be able to do something. We should be able to move people. And that's a sense of determination. We won't let this happen to our community. That's what inside the room look like. Okay, the person on the far right is an interim superintendent. He was hired just to, you know, stay there until they find somebody. The first one is the board president, and she voted in my favor. The next one is the board vice president. He voted in my favor. The third one is a board member. She's the one who voted against me from the beginning. Jim Reed, that man, he voted for me in my favor first, then he changed his vote. And the last woman, Judy Aaron, she voted in my favor and changed her vote. And so the two on the right voted for me, and they keep that vote. The two on the left voted for and then changed. Now, people call it racial right from the beginning, because the two people who voted for me and kept the vote were Latino Americans. One came from Puerto Rican background, one came from Mexican American background. And the two that changed their votes were white. So people said, wait a minute, this is racist. Racist. Okay, that's what people identify with. But there's more to it than that. And that shows the boardroom. There were a lot of people who came, a lot of white people who sat and occupied the seats and didn't have their parents. A lot of the teachers who did not want to see change, improvement. Okay. The two people that changed their vote, one of the person that changed their vote is Jim Reed. Okay. Later the coalition found out that the teacher union did not want me to be in that position. Why? They had their own reasons. They said that if I go into that district, I'll change things, I'll make it harder for white teachers, because right now they need retirement. They can coast through and retire at a high salary rate. Okay? If I go in and I say, wait a minute, the kids are not getting enough instruction. Why do we pay teachers retirement benefits so high? I'm going to move some of that money here, and the benefits will be lower. They don't like that, because that's what I've done in another district. Another thing that they did not like, because they look at my record as a board member in the other district. I said, wait a minute, 90% of the kids are minority, and yet 90% of the teachers are white. How can they communicate to their parents and the community? We need to level. So they felt threatened. So the teacher union controlled the board through these two people, okay. Because they pay for the board members to get elected. So the board members have to vote the way they want it. That's the power. So people for the first time realize that, oh, wait a minute, these people make decisions on our kids' behalf, and they're not making decisions on what's best for our kids. They make decisions based on what's best for the right teachers. We better do something about that. So that's the way they move. These are all the signs that these people made. And you know, I did not make any one of them. They did it on their own, and they brought it. It was so amazing. And the coalition, I am not part of the coalition, but I support them. The reason is to raise the quality of education and motivate the children. It's very clear. There's an article in Asian Week recently. They interviewed Judy Aarons, one of the board members that changed her vote. And she said that she's very hurt when people said it was racial. Because, look at, she said, after years of effort and attempt, she was able to convince the other trustees to give official recognition to our custodial course, which consists largely of Vietnamese Hispanic employees. She said, how can I be racist when, you know, I recognize a custodian force? Okay? She was clueless. So when that article came out, people sent me email and said, Kim, what, you applied for the wrong position. If you applied for head of custodian, she would have no problem. She would have voted for you. Okay? But you see, and she said this in a national interview of a magazine. And she said, how did they call me racist? Look, I recognize the custodian force. And, you know, they're Vietnamese and Latino. Okay. So what happened here? I want to point out to you that when people have certain bias and they are in position of decision-making power, their decision would become policy. And what happened to that policy would keep everything status quo and will oppress, continue to oppress other people. And they don't see it. They do not see that. Okay? So that's when things happen and stays in the same place, it's become institutional racism. It's not individual discrimination in which a law forbids. Institutional racism, there's no law against it unless you can prove it. So it's very hard. This is very telling. You're looking at the district teachers, so the blue represent the angle, the white teachers, 70.8. But you're looking at the students, only 19.5, all right. You're looking at the red is Asian, 11.1 Asian, but the Asian students made up 33.5, and the Latino students 38.7, but you have only 5.4 Hispanic teachers, I mean teachers who can communicate to the parents. If you can't communicate to the parents, how can you build partnerships? How can you say, John is doing really great, but we need to help you with this and this at home. You cannot do that kind of relationship building when you don't know the culture and you cannot communicate. That's just a number. Okay. This is what happened in that district. You look at the, we compare the three school districts of the same size, and we look at 100% is the average, the state level. In terms of library books, in Westminster, only 17% of the funding has goes into library book. But looking at the deferred compensation, that means benefit for retiring teachers, 5 times that of the state average. So they put in more money for the older white teachers as they retire. When they retire, they don't do anything for the district, but they get so much money. Whereas the kids don't get enough money for textbooks or library books. But they don't want anyone to see this. The coalition gathered this information. They did things to show why. They asked questions, why did the teacher union not want kid want to go in there? What's the matter? What is it that they're afraid? What is it that they want to have? This is what they want to have. Okay. They also dig up information that every year that you stay in this district, your grades go down. You learn less. You're less able to go to high school and college. I know this when I went into the interview, and I questioned them more. Okay, so the teachers know that I will make them work harder. They don't want to work harder. I have been a teacher for 13 years, and I trained teachers for 13 years, so I know. Other people might not push them because, you know, they work together, but they know I will push them, so they don't want me to do that. So, the community was outraged. They said, what can we do? What's next? So they said, okay, we have to use our vote as our voice. We have to understand that our children is our future. And in order to guarantee our children a good future, we need to use our vote. So that's an effort to mobilize the community. The coalition identified 2 candidates. They said, okay, you saw some of the rally they have assigned. Today we rally, tomorrow we vote. In order to vote, you have to have a candidate that you can believe in. So there's 3 board members that have their terms up in November. We will keep one because she's a good person. She kept her vote. We will replace 2 board members who were teachers control and replace them with these. Lupe Fisher, she is Latino. She came from that community. She worked in that district for 25 years as a classified employee. She is very upset at the treatment of Latino students. Connie Hong, she's a teacher in Garden Grove. She felt that we need an educator who can work with the board and who comes from the community. So these are candidates that will replace them. But in order for them to be elected, we have to do a lot of work. We have to tell parents. raised, to put their names in the paper, their names on the radio, put signs and all of that. So this is where we are. We understand that collectively we can make a difference. And in Cree language we say, together we can. Si se puede, một cây là chẳng nên năm, ba cây tự tại nên hòn núi cao. I'm running out of time, but I want to show you. This is interesting. Mr. Doe from Marlborough, he's made a connection with Amanda's case. Okay. A student shared, what good it is to go straight A's and receiving all these hours when you don't know who you are. There's this emptiness and void in me that I long to feel. I can't say anything to worry my parents and my teachers wouldn't understand anything. I'm pushing for this school to include the history of the community as part of the education. So, what I want to tell you is the future isn't something hidden in a corner. Something that we build in the present. We started with Paulo Freire, and I wanted to end with him. And my message to you, take the leap of faith, get involved, stop being a bystander. Okay. Find out what issues prevalent in your community that need your support, get involved. That's the only way to build community. And don't just get involved within the business community. You need to do alliances with other communities to make it happen. Okay, thank you.
So what's the demographic of your district?
Westminster or Gondro?